live streaming. Everybody, Chapter 8, get ready. Put your hands together for Chapter 8, Kit. To Kit from Mom. Subject, the five stages of everything sucks. Relatable. It's the middle of the night. Just stumbled across this attached article, read the five stages of grief. 1. Denial. 2. Anger. 3. Bargaining. 4. Depression. 5. Acceptance. Of course, bacon should totally be number one on this. Oh my god. Of course, bacon should totally be number one on this list. Also, I have decided on skipping over the first three steps, Sam, heading straight for depression. You with me? To Mom, from Kit.
Read to me, IRL, from me, IRL. Five stages
of everything sucks. You should really text like a normal person. Who emails anymore? Thing this list is missing. Chocolate. Netflix binges. Pajamas. As for depression, I already beat you to it. Sure am. Hashtag living my best life. Oh my god. What was that? No one talks like that over the internet. Who puts a hashtag in an email? You don't even put hashtags while you're texting. It's only on, like, Instagram or Twitter. Hey, Gabriel's... What should I make Gabriel's voice? Hey, Gabriel says when I walk into the pizza palace. He is overly excited, as if I didn't just sit behind him in calc less than 2 hours ago. Like we are in the arrivals hall of a large international airport, and I'm just backing from a year-long trip around the world. He lets go of Justin, but who he has in a headlock to envelop me in a big hug. Hey guys, I say, and move my lips in the way I think approximates a smile. It requires a complicated muscle coordination. More exhausting than that time Violet made me try pilates. I don't know what those are. A physical fitness system. Drew, are you there?
Yeah, but I have no idea where we are because you keep going in and out.
Drew, this is a problem on your side. There's no way this is a problem on my side.
That sounds great.
Drew. So, do I have to yell everything? Or is it, like, unrelated to how loud I talk?
That's not much better.
Listen to it from the live stream then, Drew. I think that's our best bet.
Live stream audio, is that what you're trying to tell me?
Yes.
Okay.
So, Drew, are you listening to it on the live stream now?
You can start.
Are you listening to it on the live stream now?
Yes.
All right.
Yeah, you're gonna hear this like way when you're gonna be in the middle of reading and you're just gonna hear me talking. This is really bad. I'll shut
Yeah,
up.
it's gonna suck. But it's better than not hearing anything. I look over and Violet jumps out of the booth, runs over to me. Annie gives me a brownie salute, which is one of our inside jokes. And I see I've won her over just by showing up. That makes me smile for real. And then the smiling makes me tear up, so I stop doing it. You came, Violet says. Sorry. I can't stay long. As soon as the words slip out, I realize they are true. After dropping David off, being alone in the car felt unbearable. The pizza palace was closer than home. Since the accident, my mom has been making me drive at every opportunity. She claims she doesn't want me to develop a lifelong phobia, and I guess her plan is mostly working. Still, when I'm alone in the car, I flinch at passing SUVs, and I'm way too aware of how fast all the other traffic is going, how thin the line is between us, how easily one mistake can kill us all. Cars are terrible, powerful, destructive machines. Maybe 16-year-olds shouldn't be allowed to drive them. Maybe no one should. Now, here with everyone, I feel no better than I did on the ride over. I'm sweaty around my friends lately, like socializing is a form of cardio without the post-exercise endorphins or smugness. I need to beg my body to push through this. Can't believe you ditched newspaper yesterday. It's just like a mix of New Jersey and bratty teen. And he says, after all that work, you're just gonna throw it all away at the chance at editor-in-chief? I shrug. Gabriel uses that as an opportunity to start massaging my soldier shoulders.
You look tight. You look tight, he says.
For about 5 minutes last year, Gabriel and I were together. One of those stupid things that happen because you find yourselves in the corner of a room at a party where everyone is drunk. He kissed me suddenly, like a bird swooping to pick garbage from a can. And after I recovered from the surprise attack, I kissed him back. That Monday, he held my hand in the hallway at school, and then we made out again later in the 7-Eleven parking lot in between taking sips of our Slurpees. 2 weeks later, he broke it off, said something about us being better off as friends, which was fine by me. I wasn't particularly into Gabriel, but it was fun having someone to kiss and hold hands with, having, for just a little while, a pleasant distraction. Now, though, I'd really like him to stop touching my shoulders. In fact, I wish there were a way to transfer his hands to Annie, who for the past few months has had a secret, unexplainable crush on him. She's never said it out loud, but Violet and I know she's hoping he'll ask her to prom. There's nothing wrong with Gabriel on paper, but there isn't really much there. Annie's not the type of girl who should have to settle for pleasant distractions. She's too cool for that. Jessica, Willow, and Abby burst through the door in a loud explosion of giggles and then stop at the counter to get their Diet Cokes before heading to the back to join us. I don't really like these girls. I have never liked these girls. And yet somehow they are on the periphery of our friend group. Okay, fine. We are actually on the periphery of their friend group, since as a trio, Jessica, Willow, and Abby are by far the most popular girls in the junior class. I have no idea how they've managed to swing it. Popularity is an undefinable thing in Mapleview, which, as best I can tell, involves a whole lot of uneared, effortless confidence and the ability to get other people to look at you for no reason at all. Jessica's a blonde, Willow is a brunette, and Abby is a redhead, just like every teen friend group on television. Except in this case, Sans a sassy black sidekick. Boom, best friends for life. I assume there's more to their friendship than hair color optics and an affinity for thong underwear. That taken av in That taken individually is there is the distant. Oh my god. That taken individually, there is the distant possibility they might actually be interesting people. I doubt I will ever know, though, since they travel as a pack. The reason I don't like them is not because they're walking cliches and therefore like to dabble in being quintessentially mean girls, but because their conversations are boring. We live in a small and privileged bubble in Mapleview, and I've never understood their desire to make it seem even smaller. Boys! Boy! What? Boys! Abby says by the way of hello, and the way it rolls off her tongue makes it sound like she is both belittling them and flirting with them at the same time. I practice her intonation in my head. Boys. File it away for use far, far in the future. Like college. No, that's just a year and a half away. Maybe it will come in handy if I go to graduate school. And ladies! The guys act differently when the three of them are around. More nervous, even louder. Gabriel mercifully stops his massage. Justice smiles goofily. He and Jessica used to hook up, but last I heard, she broke it off with him because she's been hanging out with a freshman from NYU. In the world of social climbing, college boy beats high school boy every time. Rumor has it that Justin is still devastated. So what's the deal with you and David Drucker? Willow asks. Wait, this is a... I have to do a Brady team. Teen voice. So what's the deal with you and David Drucker? Willow asks me. And for no good reason, I feel my hands curl into fists. Guess I am moving through the five stages of grief after all. Making my designated pit stop at number two. Anger. Nothing's up. We're friends, I say. Come on, you're not really friends with David Drucker, Abby says. And sighs dramatically. Like everything I have to say is frustrating. Sitting at someone's slot table doesn't make you besties. What do you care, I ask. I'm a little too eager to engage and take them down, which is stupid. They are my friends, sort of. This is not what I do. Of course I don't care, Jessica says and laughs. And it's true. I'm sure she doesn't care. He got in your car today, though, Willow says. I saw him. I decide suddenly that I hate Willow the most. She was born with more than her fair share of the same magic Lauren Drucker has, but without the warmth. Like I said, we're friends. He's pretty interesting, actually.
Interesting?
Gabriel asks, though it's in no way a question. Leave it to Gabriel to always go for the easiest response. Reflexive, empty sarcasm. Like how I do it. That's me. My anger deflates. It's not real anyway. It's just a stupid stage in a stupid article. That's how desperate my mom and I are. We look for guidance from Oprah.com. Too bad there's another step they forgot to list. The sudden onset of not giving a crap about anythingness. What I now think of as astronaut helmet syndrome. Suddenly I look around and see everyone talking and laughing. No less than 2 feet in front of me. And they feel miles away. We're all strangers to each other in the end. Turns out grief not only morphs time, but space too. Somehow increases the distance between you and other people. I should ask David if there's any science behind that idea.
What was Jessica's voice?
What, Emma? Let's talk about more important things, Jessica says.
Right, one word, Willow says.
Prom!
Abby finishes, and he quickly glances at Gabriel. But if he notices her looking at him, he doesn't show it.
Gross,
my mom says as she shovels the Weight Watchers version of fettuccine Alfredo into her mouth. Lately, during dinner, we talk in single-word sentences, a shorthand we've adopted because we're too tired for anything more. When I close my eyes at night, the projector in my brain flips on, and there it is, right on the ceiling, or a peat loop of a bird's-eye view of the crash. Like, it's fun for me, watching this imaginary horror film, to stand by and watch the other car, a navy blue Ford Explorer, plow into my father, on repeat again and then again. I smell rubber and smoke, metallic blood, so sharp and recognizable it can't be anything other than what it is. A taste and a smell in one. Life in its opposite. I attempt to figure out at what point a foot would have needed to touch the brake for there never to have been a crash at all. As if high school level math could just this once come in handy. When I finally do fall asleep, high school math is very useful. You can use it, not directly useful, but, like, indirectly useful, you know? Like, good enough. When I finally do fall asleep,
I knew you were going to say something about that.
I have a dream about Newton's third law. For every action, there is an equal and opposing reaction. Force against force.
Lucas. So what you're saying is that without the body of a true science, math is entirely useless and pointless.
Okay, Drew, you're going to hear this like 5 seconds from now. But math? On its own is completely different from science. And you want to know what? Science borrows from math. Yeah, not the other way around. Like, ooh, science creates math. No, you're dumb. You're dumb. You're an idiot. Math comes first, and then science just rips it off like the dirty, crusty hand thieves they are. Now, though, when I finally do fall asleep, I have a dream about Newton's third law. For every action, there is an equal and opposing reaction, force against force. The car crushed and disposed of like an empty potato chip bag. Snap, crackle. Here now, though, it's just my mom and me and the sad sounds of us chewing. And then, inexplicably, there's a key in the lock. Could the doctor have been right and my dad was just lost, momentarily displaced? He will waltz in the door and ruffle my hair and call me kitty cat? Of course that doesn't happen. My dad has not risen from the dead. Even David's ridiculous theory of consciousness doesn't allow for that. It's just Uncle Jack, the only other living person who has a key to our home. Right. Much more logical. What are you doing here, my mom? Why was that accent? I have to get the voice right. What are you doing here? Why do I say it like that? What are you doing here? She's not British, she's Indian. I don't care anymore. What are you doing here? Why do I just instinctively do an accent? Just do an American. What are you doing here? My mom asks. Her tone is sharp and Wait! No, I should... What are you... What are you doing here? My mom asks. Her tone is sharp and betrays her disappointment. It's okay, I want to say. I thought it was going to be Dad, too. Normally, my mom would be happy to see Jack. When he first got divorced, it was my mother's idea to invite him to stay over at our house on the weekends. So his boys were... What? It was my mother's idea to invite him to stay over at our house on the weekends. His boys were with... the weekends his boys were with Aunt Katie. He was sad then, too. And my mom cooked him hearty, comforting breakfast. Pancakes and eggs and bacon and good coffee. The good coffee. What? Okay. The cure for a broken heart. The cure for a... I forgot her voice. The cure for a broken heart, she'd say. I'm keeping British. I can't not do it. She would serve the food on her good platters. And then the three of them, my mom, dad, and Jack, would sit at the dining table, passing around sections of the New York Times while I played with my phone. This right here is my definition of heaven, my dad used to say. My best friend and my two girls and the paper of record. You're not answering your cell, and I was... You're not answering your cell, and I was worried, Jack says, and looks at my mother. But she stares at her gelatinous noodles. Gelatinous. I know what it is. It's gelatinous. Jack's tall and bald and lanky. He wears glasses, big plastic ones that are both dorky and cool at the same time, and swanky suits that look imported from England. He's not good looking. His nose is too big for his face. His eyes are a little squinty behind his frames. He's a little pasty, but there's something familiar and comforting about him. Want some dinner? I ask, and jump up to check the freezer. We have lean cuisine. You do realize this is not real food, right? He keeps his tone light, so much lighter than the feeling in the room. That does not sound light, but that's the one downfall of that voice. How about a glass of wine? My mom asks, suddenly unfreezing, as if her play button has been pushed, and she and she pisses herself getting a bottle out, opening it up, pouring herself a large glass. She gulps it down. Only then does she pour out two more, another for her and one for Jack. Ice cream too, I say, tossing him the pint of mint chocolate chip I find in the freezer. He grabs a spoon from the drawer and digs right into the container. Uncle Jack hasn't bothered to shave, and his almost beard is dotted with gray hairs. He looks about as depressed as my mother and I feel. How's Evan, I ask, just to make some conversation. Evan is one of Jack's sons. He's 14 and also goes to Mapleview. We used to hang out when we were younger, when our families would vacation together before his parents got divorced. Evan and I and his younger brother, Alex, would make sandcastles and tackle each other in the ocean. And I used to complain to Aunt Katie that they should have made at least one girl for me to play with. Those chimps don't feel real anymore, like a memory of something I once saw on television. Going to junior prom, apparently, Jack says and smiles. That's a big deal for a freshman, I say. How about you? Nah, not going. I avoid looking at my mother. I have a feeling my skipping prom falls under the same category as my not sitting with my friends at lunch. It will inspire, at the very least, a discussion. Your dad would have wanted you to go. He'd want you to have fun, Jack says. Not mope around with us old folks. Let's not talk about what Robert would have wanted, my mom cuts in, her voice icy and sharp. I didn't mean to step on any toes, Jack says softly. Then don't. Mandy, you can't avoid me forever. I can try. I'm just doing my job as executor. There's estate stuff we need to take care of. I don't have the authority to. Wow, it's getting late, and I have a lot of work to do. No, that's my mom. That's her, not mom. Not my mom. Wow, it's getting late, and I actually have a lot of work to do. My mom jumps out of her chair. But just like that, she walks out of the room, taking her glass of wine with her. I'll help. No, that's her. I'll help, I say to Jack, after what feels like a long time in which we both sat there, staring at the empty space my mother left behind. Just tell me what you need and I'll do it. My voice sounds empty. I'm as useless as I feel. Uncle Jack hands me the pint of ice cream, and the two of us pass it back and forth until it's finished.
Tia and everybody. I hope you had a good old time with me and my buddy old, big old buddy old pal Drew. Have a good day, Drew.
That's a good chapter. Good, I hope it doesn't take so long for this audio to get to you. Good job, Lucas. You did great.
Thank you, Drew. Thank you.